the man, the legend, the icon, Mr. Miyamoto. Bill, senior managing marketing manager at Nintendo, thank you for helping me. My Japanese isn't up to par enough to have a conversation. So thank you, as always, for doing your translation.
Yes. Thank you for having us.
So where to begin? First off, I'll let you know that many of you have submitted your questions to me, so we'll be incorporating those throughout the night. But in order to go forward and talk about Super Mario Run and how far we've come to an iOS device, you know, playing on a Nintendo, let's talk about the timeline, because in the 80s, you've been doing this for over 30 years now. Why go into gaming, and why keep that passion and fun alive?
Well, I keep making games because people keep playing games.
あのね、やっぱり技術がほら、ゲームって技術がどんどんどんどん新しい技術が入ってくるし、で、自分自身もどんどん新しい経験していくでしょう。 そうすると次にやりたいものがずっと出てくるので。
Well, and I think, you know, one of the main reasons that I like to continue to make games is because technology keeps evolving. And I keep having, you know, my own personal life experiences, and I keep looking for new ways to combine the two into new games.
And technology made it more challenging now. We look at the breadth of graphics and the capability that we see just with Super Mario Run, but was it easier to create in a time of 8-bit or harder?
いろいろあってね、あのゲームデザインっていう意味では 8-bitの頃の方がこうシンプルで、で、絵もシンプルですし、あの動きもそんなつけられない。だからゲームをちゃんと考えるっていう意味ではその頃の方が面白かったんですね。
Well, there's a variety of different ways you can look at it. You know, from the 8-bit days, the technology was simpler, the graphics were simpler, and so it was easier to focus directly on the gameplay itself and on making that fun.
今はほら、絵も豪華になったし、昔なら5人ぐらいで作って、俺たちが作ったって言えたんですけど、なんかちょっと作るだけでも30人ぐらい人がいて、一体誰が作ったのかわからないっていう風になってます。
And now, of course, you know, the graphics are much more impressive. Back in the 8-bit days, you know, there would be 5 of us working on a game, and we could say with pride, you know, I made this. And now, just to make something small, it takes at least 30 people. And you don't really know who was responsible for which elements of everything that was created, and it's hard to have that clarity.
それでも俺が必要だろうっていうところをちゃんとこう見せ続けるっていうのがモチベーションになってる。So the
battle that I'm always fighting is that, you know, we have all of these talented programmers and artists, and I have to keep reminding them why I'm still important in the process.
けどね、もう一つね、技術的に言うとね、あの8ビットの頃って本当にアセンブラーでプログラムを書く、もうあの本当に ちょっと変更するだけでも大変な時代があったんですけど、今この iOSとかになるともう環境がすごく整ってるので、まあ、プログラムを書くっていうことはみんな自由にやってくれるんですね。そうすると、ゲームをこう仕様変更するって僕らがちょっと内容を変えるっていうのも結構プログラマーが早く対応してくれて、すごいスピードでゲームができていくのは事実だと思います。
But one area where things have changed and made it more convenient was that back in the 8-bit days, we would actually have to use an assembler in order to compile the code, in order to affect our changes in the game. But now, particularly in developing on something like iOS, the development environment is so advanced that, you know, we have what we call our spec changes, where we're making minute changes to the level design or the program, and our programmers can implement that very, very quickly, and we're able to see the results very quickly. So that's a big benefit.
Many people know you as a developer and a programmer of such iconic games, but really humble beginnings as an apprentice first at Nintendo.
まあ今はその偉大なゲームデザイナーになってるんですけれども、あのその初回は任天堂に入社した頃は本当のまあアプレンティスみたいな低いレベルで入りましたよね。そうですよね。僕はそうですね。まずあのね、会社にあのリクルートの電話をしたんですよね。
そしたらね、デザイナー募集してないって言われたんです。Well, yeah, actually, I
called up a recruiter and said, are you looking for any designers?
あの、僕、工業デザイナーだったんですね。 で、インダストリアルデザイナーは別に募集してないって言われたので、それで無理やりその面接をしてもらうようになって、それで開発の部長さんに直接自分の作品を持って行って会社に入りました。
So, I studied industrial design, but they told me that they weren't looking for any industrial designers, but somehow I managed to force them to give me an interview. and then I went to the department head of one of the design teams, and I showed him one of the things that I had created from my portfolio, and that was how I got the job.
それで会社に入った次の年ぐらいにスペースインベーダーがバーンと流行って、それで任天堂もビデオゲームをもっと作ろうという話になって、それでこう初めてビデオゲームの絵を描くようになったんですね。
And then about a year or two after I joined Nintendo, Space Invaders came out and became a huge hit, and so Nintendo decided to go into the video game business, and that was how I got my start designing graphics.
And really, speaking of start, it kind of all started with Super Mario, and I got to tell you, dude, that's a weird premise. You got two plumbers, a princess, and a barrage of other very random characters. How did this come in your brain? And how did you get them to like buy in?
Yeah, 最初はなんかでっかいゴリラですからね。
Well, actually, it started off with a big gorilla, of course.
ゲームってね、面白いゲームって何かというと、自分がこうやってみて、で失敗して、自分が反省して、今度はこうしようって思う。それからもう一つは、周りで見てる人がこう見てて、こう俺に貸せと、俺の方がうまくやれるから貸しなさいっていうふうなゲームが面白いと思うんですよね。
Well, I think when you talk about video games and what makes them fun, for me there's two things. And one is you play the game and you see the response on screen and you try something out and you fail. And then you think about why you failed and you try to think about what can I do differently and you go back in and you try again. And it's that thinking process that I think is a lot of fun for people. And then the other is that when somebody else is watching you play, they kind of, they look at you and they're like, give me the controller, I can do better than that.
でそれをしようと思うと、画面に映ってるものがみんなが理解できてそれらしい状態、あこの人はきっとここへ行くんだなって、いや女の子がいたらそこへ行くかな、助けに行くかなとか、そういう状態をちゃんと見せるのがすごく大事で、僕は絵が描けたのでプログラムは組めないんですけど、絵が描けたので、じゃあそれを武器にしてその表現でゲームを作ろうとしたんですね。
So if you think about sort of those two premises being the root of fun of video games, then what you realize is that what you're showing on the screen has to be simple enough that everybody can understand what they're seeing and what they need to do. You can see, oh, there's this character, and clearly I think he needs to get over here, so I'm going to try to get him over there. And because I was the one who could draw the graphics, the programmer couldn't draw the graphics, I was drawing the graphics. I used that to my advantage to be able to help design those games and kind of paint that picture.
それで最初のゲームがゴリラがいて、こうスロープがあるから、まあ、スロープを登っていてゴリラのとこに行くって。で、このおじさんが初めて出てきたんですね。
And so that's why in my very first game, there was the gorilla up top,and you saw the sloped girders, and so it was very apparent that, oh, I think I have to follow those girders to get up to the gorilla, and then that's where this guy first appeared.
だからその時はカーペンターだったんですよ。
But at that point, he was a carpenter.
で、この二人、兄弟がもう一人出てくるようになって、それでルイージが出てきて、その時にノコノコってカメがいて、カメが出てきそうなシチュエーションで、しかも下に行ったカメが上に戻ってくるシチュエーションで、パイプをつけたんですね。でそれはこれどう見てもニューヨークの地下やってそれでプランマーにした。
And then the next game, of course, that we had a second player, and I decided that they would be brothers, and they were going to be battling against these turtles. And so when I thought about, well, where can we expect to see turtles? And the turtles have to come from above and drop down below and then find a way to get back up above. I thought, well, they'll need pipes to walk through in order to get back up above. And then we kind of created that scene and looked at it, and I said, well, clearly this is...the New York sewers, and that's why we made them plumbers.
で、最後が、じゃあマリオが大きくなったり小さくなったりするって、で大きくなる不思議なアイテムって、 まあ、不思議なアイテムというかキノコだろうと。じゃあキノコの森に迷い込んでいくマリオが何をするかというと、きっとプリンセスがいて、そのプリンセスを助けに行くんだというので、結局プリンセスとプランマーになったんです。長いアンサーです。
And then、for the next game we decided that we wanted Mario to get big and you know he'd start small and get big and get small again, and so we needed something that would make sense for why he would grow biggerAnd when we thought of, well, what mysterious thing has sort of magical properties that can make somebody grow bigger, I thought, well, you know, from fairy tales, a mushroom. And then because, you know, okay, if he's running through a forest where there's mushrooms, what's he doing? Well, obviously he's running to save a princess. And that's how we ended up with a princess and a plumber.
It's all making so much sense.
Thank you.
So much clarity.
Thank you.
Can you dive into
simple learning?
It's all very simple.
It gets more complex too, because quickly touch on Zelda, because that's another one that always comes up in terms of, you know, yeah, we got some Zelda fans here.
Heard of that.
Another one though that came from your brain, from your own life experiences that brought into the video game world.
そうですね。あの、その頃やっぱり8ビットなので、あの、壮大な世界を描きたくても絵はそんなに描けないんですよね。そうすると単純なこう絵を積み重ねながら自分で感じたのは、あ、子供の頃とかにこう山に登ったとか湖に行ったとか、そういう世界をイメージして何かをシンボリックなものを描けば、多分遊んでる人の中にもそういう世界が出てくるかなっていうことで、割と、あ、そうか、自分の体験にあるものを作っていったらみんなに理解されるなって感じたんですね。
Well, so of course back in the 8-bit days, because it was so simple, you couldn't draw、you know, detailed graphics, and particularly for Zelda、you know, it was very simple tiles that we were using. And so in wanting to create an adventure game、the first thing I thought was, well, how can I create the graphics in a way that anyone can understandAnd the first thing that I did was I went back to my own experiences of exploring the mountains and coming across lakes. And I thought, well, maybe if what I can do is draw sort of simplified representations of things that I've experienced myself, then perhaps people playing can see those simplified representations and they can connect to them through their own experiences and recognize them for what they represent in the game. And so it's a little bit of using the limited graphics coupled with your own imagination to help you, the player, paint the full picture of the world.
It's amazing how, in terms of the timeline and creation, you can go from 8-bit and have such success, and then completely change the way we look at gaming with the 3DS and the Wii Fit, and now here we are playing on a smartphone. How do you keep nailing it? What's the process? You're seeing the future well ahead.
Keep nailing it.
まあ、毎回当たるっていうのがどうやって当たるんですか。
どうやって当たるか。そう、これね、毎回売れたらみんなで運が良かったねっていうことにしてるんですよ。
Well, every time if something does well, we always say, "Wow, we got lucky."
だから売れなかったら運が悪かったねっていうこと。
And if something doesn't sell well, we say, "Oh, that was unfortunate."
で。今でもね、あの、ずっと手塚っていうディレクターと、で、中郷というプログラムディレクターがいて、もう30年以上その3人で仕事をするんですけども。
So, you know, but really there's been sort of a core team that I've worked with for the past 30 years. There's Takashi Tezuka, who's one of my main directors. And then we have a programming director, who's Mr. Nakago.
でその3人はね、それはやってみようということが見つかるまでなかなか始めない、何かいろいろなことを試して、あ、これはやってみようということになったら初めて一緒に作り始めるんです。
And so really the three of us, we kind of never get started on a project until we all agree on this is the thing we want to do. We try out lots of different things, and then finally when all of us agree, we say, okay, let's do this. That's when things start moving forward.
完成するまで面白いとか褒めたことがないって、いつもここが面白くない、あこが面白くないって、もうずっとロム出しするまでまだ面白くない面白くないって言い続けてるんですよ。だから自分たちでその面白くないということが楽しみになってる。
But、what's interesting is that when we're making a game, we never tell each other what's fun about the game. All we ever do is we say, man, this part is no fun. No, that's not fun. This isn't any good. And we'll go through this process all the way through to completion until we master up the ROM before we ever have a chance to sit down and actually think about what's fun about the game. So we kind of have fun talking about what's not fun about it.
それとあのいつも売れるので売れてしまうとねみんないい思い出になるので幸せな気分になってしまうので売れるかどうかわからない間に反省会というのを一回するんですよ必ず今回のプロジェクトで何が反省するべきだったかというのをやってそれから結果を見るように割としてますね。
And so then, you know, when the games do well, and they sell well, then obviously all of a sudden all of those days we spent criticizing the product all come as, you know, wonderful memories that we have of working on it. But what we always do, even before we see the results of releasing the game, is we always have sort of a post-mortem where we go back and we think about, well, you know, what went wrong and how could we have done this better before we even see the results.
だからこのスーパーマリオランもまずまだ反省するべきところあるんですけどもほぼやりたいこと全部やったのであとは15日までに反省会を帰ってやらないとダメです。
So, even with Super Mario Run, you know, we do feel like we've created a game that I think is very fun. There are a few things we could have done differently, but what's important right now is I have to get back to Japan so that we can do our post-mortem before December 15th.
Perhaps a perfect segue to Super Mario Run and coming onto the iOS platform. Was there a catalyst that said we need to be moving into the smartphone world?
そのモバイルで開発するあのその起動となったきっかけとなったことは何でしょうね。
本当に正直なところ言ってね、やっぱりあの世界中で一番たくさんの、まあ、僕らは一つのプラットフォームというか一つのあのアーキテクチャでものを作りたいんですね。というのはマルチにこういろんなもののために作ると本当のクリエイティブをやる仕事以外の仕事がいっぱい出てくる。だから働いてる作ってるっていうのはもう全部一つのものを作るために仕事をしたいので割と任天堂のハードの上で独占的に作るということを繰り返してきたんですけども。
Well, there are a couple of reasons. One is we did want to reach the broadest possible audience, and so that plays into it. The other is, and if you look at the way that Nintendo has designed its own games, what we've always done is we've always focused on a single platform, our own platform, and we've repeatedly designed a game specifically for a single platform. And the reason that we like to do this is because when you design a game for multiple different platforms, you end up having to do a lot of extra work that's not related to the creative side of game development just to get the game to run on those other platforms.
で、幸い、任天堂のハードウェアというのは一応トップではなくても常に一番安くて一番買いやすくてで、あのたくさんの人が持ってるという機械の場所をずっと維持してきたんですけども。
And we've been fortunate over the years because we'd always managed to, you know, even if our own platforms didn't have the largest install base, we always had a platform that was generally the most affordable and we could reach a lot of consumers with. And so we always felt fortunate about that.
で、今でも 3DS なんかも5000万とか1億とかもそんなに恥ずかしい数字ではない台数はあるんですけども、スマートフォンというのはもう今やはるかにそういう数字を超えた。みんなが触れる機会になったんですね。
Yeah, and so even, you know, with the platform like the 3DS, you know, selling between 50 and 100 million globally, that's not a number to sneeze at. But if you look at the number of people out there who have iPhones, obviously it's a much, much larger number.
そうすると、で、しかもスマートフォンが、あの、ゲームって専用機なので、能力の割にはゲームのパフォーマンスすごく出るんですけども、まあ、汎用機っていうのはどうしてもパフォーマンスを抑えて作る。けど抑えても十分こうインタラクティブなゲームが作れるぐらいな技術に今なったと感じたんですね。
I think the other thing that's changed is that when you're working on a hardware platform that's dedicated strictly to gaming, you're able to use the full power of that platform to design your games. And whereas when you're working on a multifunctional device like a smartphone,you're not always able to pull the full power out of the device because the device is having to perform other functions. But what we've seen over the last few years is that with devices like iPhone, even though the functionality is there for other purposes as well, what we're able to get out of the device from a gaming performance standard is now meeting our own expectations for the performance that we want to get out of our own games.
で、あの、本当にやろうというまでやろうと言わない人たち3人でやってるので、まずスマートフォンの環境でこれの原型を作ってみて、で、あのワンボタンだけで遊べるシングルタッチでこう遊べるゲームを作ってみて、あ、結構遊べそうという手応えがつかめたのでやろうということに。
And then, of course, because, you know, as I mentioned, the three of us, we never actually make anything until we all three decide that it's time. You know, we'd been experimenting with ideas around a one-button control scheme for Mario, where all you do is jump. And when we tried this out and tried it out on iPhone and found, hey, we found a great way to make an accessible Mario game and bring it to iPhone and reach a lot of people, that was when we finally decided to make Super Mario Run.
で、このアップルさんがすごい最高のこう協力をしてもらえることになったので、よし早く作って早く売ろうって。
And then of course, Apple has been really just the best partner in all of this, and with their support and their cooperation, we decided, okay, let's put all of our energy into this and make the game as quickly as we can.
Question submitted from Twitter from Noah Sanchez: Were there any challenges developing for touch screens?
そうですね。僕あのちょっと言ってタッチスクリーンっていうのは任天堂はまあ静電タッチではないんですけど、実はあの iPhone が発表するより早くタッチスクリーンを使ったのは任天堂なんです。世界中の人はちょっと忘れていってる。
So, one thing that I think maybe people around the world often forget is that although we didn't use capacitive touch, Nintendo actually released a device that used touch as an input mechanism before the iPhone even released.
Well played.
けどね、あのそれぐらいやっぱアップルも考えいいっていう、あのだ幅広い人が簡単に使おうと思うと直感的に何かを押すっていうのが一番いいんですよ。
But and I think actually Apple has the same perspective. But if you think about it, the input mechanism that's probably simplest for everyone around the world to understand is to touch something and see it react.
だからあのタッチすることに対しての特許をたくさん取るとか、いろんな実験をするはたくさんやってきました今まで。
And so we've done a lot of experiments and registered a lot of patents related to touch control.
けど今度はね、一番魅力的だったのはその、まあ、こうスワイプするとか 3D タッチをするとかいろんな希望も出てきたんですけど、いやもっと誰が触っても間違わないっていうので、タッチをしている時間長さだけで作ろうと。そしたらこう電車に乗りながらでもこういつでも気軽に遊べるやないっていうので、その実験をしたんですね。
But for us, what was most interesting was, you know, we had gotten a lot of requests for things like, oh, why don't you include swipe or 3D touch control? But for us, what was most interesting was the idea of, no, you just control just using a touch and the length of your touch, and that's it. And we felt that by taking that approach, it would be easiest for the widest number of people to immediately know what to do and to be able to play the game, you know, standing up one-handed on a train, for example.
Perhaps we could show a little footage too, right?
あ、じゃあちょっと映像を出しましょうか。
あ、そうですね。はい。
Yeah.
Let's do it. It's a tease. You have to buy it, people.
あのもうすでに触ってもらった人どれぐらいいますか。
How many of you here have actually had a chance to try out the demo that's here in the store?
ああ今日特別にそこに置いてありますんで、
well, I think they're all back there, so afterwards you can try it out.
あの本当にね、あのタッチする長さだけなんですけども、まあいろんな調整で初めての人もこう分かりやすく遊べるし、で上級者もね、結構任天堂なんかはもう上級者ばかりですから、もう結構熱くなるぐらいテクニックの詰まった仕上げになりました。
So yeah, it is really just controlled based on tapping the screen and the length of your tap. And so what that means is that anybody who's playing a Mario game for the first time can instantly have fun playing. But of course, at Nintendo, we have a lot of people who are incredibly advanced gamers. And so we also designed the game in a way that there's a lot of skill and technique to discover in there. And if you're an advanced gamer, you'll also find challenge in it as well.
I want to get to one more question submitted on Twitter from Robert Paul Breeden. What was the most difficult and memorable problem in the development of Super Mario Run?
やっぱりあのそれは開発の途中で解決したんじゃなくて、もう走り続けるゲームにしようって決めたんですね。っていうのは究極あの NES のスーパープレイヤーのプレイを見てるとマリオは止まらないんですよ。
Well, this isn't something that we actually solved in the midst of development, but it was something we decided from the outset, and that was that we wanted Mario to continue running from start to finish. He'd always be moving forward. And part of the reason is that when you look at videos of super players of Super Mario Brothers, you would see that they actually never stop running.
で、マリオがちゃんと遊べない人に聞くと、左右に動くのが難しい。それから B ダッシュをするのが難しいって言うんですね。
And when you talk to people who aren't experts at Mario, oftentimes what they say is that it's hard to control Mario moving him left and right, and it's even harder to hold down the B button and make him run.
そしたら上級者と初心者全員にいいのはマリオが走り続けてることじゃないかなって。
So we decided that what would actually be best both for novices and for experts is if Mario just always ran on his own.
でそれでけど絶対それだけでは面白くならないので、その戻りたいっていう希望をどうするかとか、分かりやすくいろんなジャンプをマリオの今までのシリーズの中のいろんなジャンプをブロックの種類で分けて、その触るだけでそのいろんなジャンプをさせてあげようと。
But of course, if all Mario did was just run, that wouldn't be very fun. So then what we did was we said, okay, well, how do we give the player a way to get Mario to go backwards if they want him to go backwards at times? Or, you know, how do we bring into the game different types of jumps that Mario's had over the years in different games? And so that's when we came up with the solution to have sort of these special blocks.Where at certain points in the game you'll use a special block to do a particular type of jump or to jump backwards and sort of add that layer of action to the jumping and the running.
そういう走り続けてるけどもいろんなストレスを取ってくれるいろんな要素をどうしようか、ジャンプの要素をどうしようかっていうことを一つ解決して、もう一つはあそこまで言った
。
もう一つは今度画面もちっちゃいしよく見えないとか、それから敵にすぐ当たってしまうので結局走ってることが難しいっていうお客さんも出てくるので、マリオがある程度勝手にアクションをして、どっちかというとかっこいいアクションをしてどんどん進んでくれたらどうかって、けどその上で遊ぶ人のテクニックが活かせるようなアイデアはないかって、その部分が一番あの苦労しました。
And so then, you know, certainly we had the blocks to add these jump elements, and so that resolved that issue. But then the other was, as you're running along, you have enemies to dodge and things like that, and if Mario's running automatically, it can be hard for people to figure out or time it right to deal with that. And so we had to add in additional action elements to the game, where Mario now has a lot of different actions versus what he's done before, hurdling, vaulting, things like that, to support with moving Mario through the level so that the player can just focus strictly on the jumping and really hone their jumping skills as part of the gameplay.
遊び慣れてくるとね、ちょっと新しい感覚があって、今までのマリオと違う感覚があって、じーっと見てるだけの方がいい瞬間があるんですよ。マリオが乗り越えていってこう登ってる最中にタップすると飛んでしまうので、登り終わるまでちょっと待ってるとか、でそのちょっとこう待ってる感じっていうのは今までのマリオにない新しいテンポが生まれて面白かったです。
And so the game actually has a very different feel from previous Mario games because it has sort of its own unique tempo or rhythm to it. There will be points in the game where Mario's running through, but you actually want to just kind of wait and watch. You know, when you jump up and Mario grabs a ledge, if you tap right away, he'll jump off the ledge and he might vault higher or jump over what you're trying to get.And so it creates these interesting moments that you haven't had in a Mario game before of waiting, that changes the tempo and gives it kind of a unique feel.
で、ヒップドロップとかありますよね。オリジナルのマリオにこうヒップドロップドーンっていうのがあるんですけど、そのヒップドロップに近い感覚で敵のそばに行った時にポンとタップするとカンって踏んでくれる。で、コーラジャンプっていう、そうして踏むと必ず高く飛んでくれるっていうのが全部オートマティックに動くので、自分はあるリズムでこうタップしてるだけで結構スーパーな技が出せるっていう。
So in previous games we had maneuvers like the ground pound, but and you would use that where you jump up and then drop down. But in this game, what you do is you'll jump towards an enemy, and right as you're about to hurdle the enemy, you tap again, and then he kind of lunges off the top of the enemy to defeat it. Or you'll have shell jumps where if you time your jump just right off of a shell, it'll bounce you higher, and that'll get you access to a different area. So there's these moments where you know, you kind of get your rhythm down and get these jumps down, and it adds a new element to the gameplay.
だから従来のようにこうピョーンって飛んで敵の上にポンって乗ると、敵を倒せるっていうあの技も出せるし、一方でこう放っておくと勝手にマリオがふってこう登るので、登った瞬間にタップしてるとガツンって敵をやっつけていってくれるっていう、なんか上級初級の倒し方があるっていう。
So there's, you know, there's kind of novice and expert ways to defeat the enemies. You can, of course, jump and land on an enemy to defeat it like you could in the previous games, or you can run right up to it and wait until the moment where Mario's hurtling over it, and as he does so, he kind of punches it down to defeat it there. And so it adds these two different ways to deal with enemies.
Is there any character you've wanted to develop or felt very passionate about that never made it?
Passion.
そう、宮本さんが作ったキャラクターで、
I mean, if the plumber made it.
まあ、そう、プラマーが有名になったっていうキャラクターがいたとしたら、うん、宮本さんが作ったキャラクターでもっと有名になってほしかったっていうの
はどうしようね。僕はあの、まあ、フォックス・マクロードに有名になってほしいんですけども。
Yeah, I always wanted Fox McCloud to be a bit more popular than he is.
うん。けどね、もう一つ、あ、もう一つはやっぱりね、ピクミンですね。
But I think one more would be Pikmin.
だからこのあたりはまだまだ作ります。
So I think these two I'll need to put some more energy into.
あの本当にユニークなキャラクターはデザイナーと一緒に作ったんですけどね、大事なキャラクターだと思ってます。
Yeah, the Pikmin are a very unique character that I worked directly with the designer on to create. So I like them quite a bit.
ハロウィンの仮装にはあんまり向かないのが残念ですけどね。
But I do think that they're not particularly well suited to Halloween costumes, which is unfortunate.
あんまりあれになりたくない。
They're a little too plain, you know.
Hate to time burglarize you. We're kind of out of time, guys. I could sit up here for hours. I'm sure you have many questions as well. I guess a final question for you. Austin Creed from Up Up Down Down is here. Come on up.He told me he wasn't going to cry, so let's help him through it.
We talked a little bit earlier today, and I showed you the Triforce tattoo that I have on my forearm. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's emblazoned there. Because that game and many of your other games had such an impact on my life, they gave me the confidence to pursue my dreams as an adult. So...I think everybody in this room has some sort of story like that. Well, you as a designer, as a creator, as a thinker, has somehow affected everyone in this room. So for them, for me, we want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Now, as a man who is always thinking ahead to the next thing, I'm curious, now that we've got Super Mario Run, where do you see the future of Super Mario going?
ああけどね、本当にね、未来のことって分からないですよね。自分が5年後に何をしてるか本当に分からない、生きてるかも分からないっていう。
Well, it's impossible to know the future. I mean, I don't know what's going to happen in 5 years. I don't even know if I'll be alive.
それで、いや、大丈夫です。
But I'm fine. I'm fine.
あの、ずっとね、これよく言う30年ぐらい前にスーパーマリオが売れて3年ぐらいの時に人気調査をしたらミッキーマウスを抜いたっていう時があって、でどう思いますかって言われたけど、そう言われてもミッキーマウスと40歳も違うもんって思った ですよね。その時に、あ、じゃあ40年後にどうなってるかがミッキーに勝ってるかどうかは戦ってもいいなって。
And so there was a point, you know, just a few years after we released Super Mario Brothers, where somebody had done sort of a character popularity poll, and Mario had become more popular at the time than Mickey Mouse had, and people said, well, how do you feel about that? And I said, well, but Mickey Mouse has been around for 40 years, and Mario's only been around for 3, and that was when I started to think that, you know, maybe what I should do is worry about what's going to be happening with Mario, you know, 40 years from now, and then we'll see how he's doing against Mickey at that point in time.
So, その時に、あ、え、ミッキーマウスってアニメーションとともにこう、漫画からアニメーションでずっと成長していったキャラクターですよね。で、そうすると、じゃあマリオはっていうと、あ、デジタル技術と一緒に成長していったらいいなと思ったんですよ。
And so at that time, what I realized was that Mickey Mouse was a character who had evolved with the evolution of cinema and animation. And so it was then that I felt that, okay, well, if I want Mario to continue to survive as a character, Mario needs to evolve with technology and video games.
だから N64 の時に 3D マリオにするのはすっごい僕は楽しかった。
And that's why, you know, when we were making Super Mario 64 for the N64, it's why it was such a fun project for me.
で、あの、マリオメーカーでエディターを作って、もうみんなにゲームを作ってもらうというのも楽しい。
And it's why when we made Super Mario Maker and released that game and all of you could then become Mario game designers, that was a very fun project for me as well.
じゃあ5年後に僕がどんな技術と出会えてるかで、その時には必ずマリオかリンクを使いますって。
So as far as what's going to happen in 5 years, it really depends on what type of new technology I come across. And then at that point in time, what I'll do is I'll partner that new technology with Mario or maybe Link and create something new.
はい。
So a huge, huge thank you. I think on a 3-2-1, you can stay up here. We're going to take a picture.On a 3-2-1, can we give a respectful arigato to Mr. Miyamoto? 3-2-1, arigato.